All right, so you heard me talk earlier today about the Institute for Collaborative Healthcare and how appreciative we are to them to working with us to put this program together. And my key partner in crime throughout this process has been Dr. Randy Vogenberg in the center. So please give Randy a big round of applause. And because Randy worked so hard to help us, I gave him my favorite panel to moderate, which is the patient panel. And with that, take it away, Randy.
Okay. Well, thank you, Joan. And I'm glad we had almost everybody come back after lunch. That's always the tough spot, especially when you have a break in the expo. So I'm really pleased to be able to moderate this session and be able to have these folks here share their patient experience. We have a lot of different experiences that are represented here on this stage. One of the other hats that I'm involved with is working in the consumer area and helping consumers be more aware and more active in the what we call self-care and helping to participate in their own solutions. So I think as we hear some of the stories and some of the experiences, how they've navigated or not navigated the healthcare system, you'll begin to get a good feel for where there's some areas they may be thinking about if you're involved in research or developing new products or other new solutions in your day-to-day activities. So what I'm going to ask the panel to do here is just introduce themselves, say who you are, just briefly tell your story about what happened to you and what happened today, and just a brief introduction of that. So why don't we start on my left with Bonnie?
Okay. First of all, I want to thank Arizona Biotechnologies for inviting me here today to be part of this patient panel. My name again is Bonnie O'Day. I am a retired RN. I was a medical case manager, and I am currently a volunteer as a patient advocate for International Cancer Association Network, also called ICANN. In 2015, I was diagnosed with metastatic squamous cell carcinoma. We talked earlier with Dr. Barker about the fact that it's good to catch these things early. For 2 years, I went from doctor to doctor complaining that I was having severe pain in my thoracic spine. And MRIs and x-rays of the thoracic spine didn't show anything, and I felt embarrassed to even go to the doctor and complain. So for 2 years, what I had went undetected. Finally, I started complaining of a little upper gastric pain, and I had a CT of the abdomen, and it showed the tumor in the gastrohepatic ligament between the liver and the pancreas and the metastasis. Later on, the diagnosis was found through needle biopsy and also through surgical removal of one of the tumors, undifferentiated squamous, unknown primary. There was lots of testing that went on, and they could not find anywhere in my body an origin primary for this type of cancer, also known as what they call cup cancers or cancers of unknown primary. So I started chemotherapy, which I was on for several months following the surgery. As often happens with many types of cancer, the chemotherapy stopped working. So we went to the results of the genome mapping. It was done by CARIS, C-A-R-I-S, genome mapping testing. And the results showed that I was PD-1, PD-L1 sensitive. So having this information, being a case manager, made me want to start doing research and trying to find somebody that would help me. And I went on several websites, including clinicaltrials.gov, and I realized as a nurse, I couldn't even understand how to get into a lot of the clinical trials. the medical language was way too over the top for the average layperson. And so I was at a point because I was afraid, I was in shock, I was frustrated, and I'm a medical person going through this. I had a secondary issue of having smoldering multiple myeloma. And because of that, everybody I called said, no, you don't qualify because of having two types of cancer. And so because of the myeloma and my association with Barbara Cavanaugh at Multiple Myeloma Foundation, I called her because as a nurse, what we do is we use our resources. And she referred me to International Cancer Advocacy Network, which is based here in Phoenix. And it was Marsha Horn that helped me with my questions, my fears, my anxieties, my all the navigating the system to help me find the right place to go for treatment. And it was a perfect fit. I was very grateful for that placement. And currently, right now, I am in a situation where I am responding to immunotherapy. And they adjust my treatment according to what my needs are. So whatever situation I'm in at the time, whether it's side effects or whatever the cancer profile is after a scan, my treatment is adjusted accordingly. And I just want to say that I'm really grateful. I'm grateful for resources, because there's a lot of good resources out there. And I'm grateful there isn't a resource for cancers of unknown primary, by the way, and there isn't a support group either. But I am grateful for the resources like International Cancer Advocacy Network. And I'm grateful for other types of resources that are out there. And to the providers, the many medical providers that work hard. And I have a wonderful relationship with my doctor as far as communication. I think it's important that you can partner with your medical providers, that you can ask questions, and that you can partner together in your care. I think this is really important. But I especially want to say that I'm thankful to all of you. I'm thankful to you as innovators, as entrepreneurs, as researchers, for trying to help people that are like us try to find our, solve our healthcare issues and help us on our journey to wellness. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Bonnie. And now we'll have Sebastian.
So my name is Sebastian Millen, and my health journey began over 10 years ago, and it basically started out like a flu, and I just got sicker and sicker, and it just was never ending, though. So my main problems were never ending fatigue. I was bedridden for a very long time, and I had a lot of pain, chronic pain in my lymph nodes, and just general, it turns out, neuropathy and things of that nature. And it was very difficult because I had a lot of great access to healthcare, actually. I got to see many incredible doctors, but, you know, due to the generalized symptoms and there was no real specific biomarkers that were just jumping out, I kind of got dead-ended with a chronic fatigue syndrome diagnosis, which is a legitimate syndrome and disease, which there's a lot of, you know, difficulties with that condition and misunderstandings. But basically, it took a really long time to get to the proper diagnosis of Lyme disease and Bartonella. And a huge part of that was the diagnostics. It's antibody-based testing, which is kind of problematic for something like Lyme disease, which is immunoevasive and suppressive. And, you know, it just really holds up in specific parts of the body a lot of times. So eventually, I did reach the right diagnosis, and treatments can be pretty tricky depending on, I think a variety of factors, probably genetics and other, environmental factors. So it can be a long journey. It can be very complicated. There's a lot of controversy around Lyme disease, which is unfortunate for patients, and there's a lot of confusion for doctors and what to look for. So I think one of the most major things for Lyme disease and even Bartonella is the diagnostics, getting diagnostics that are at decent price points and access for that, and then coming up with better therapeutics, because I do think antibiotics, while they can be very helpful, are a somewhat inelegant solution that come with certain problems as well. So you have to use them understanding the potential risks or side effects. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll turn to my right and start with Cooper.
Hi, my name is Cooper Grotenbacher. I'm 12 years old, and I was diagnosed with severe Crohn's disease in September of 2014. And how it started was my parents had noticed that I wasn't growing at all. My friends were shooting up about 4 or 5 inches taller than me. And originally I wasn't exactly tall anyways, but my parents had originally thought it was allergies, so it was around every month that I had gone in for allergy shots, and then nothing was changing, so my mom and dad asked my pediatrician to pull my growth charts, and so I think it was I had dropped from the 50th percentile to the 14th percentile, and my mom and dad just didn't know what was going on, and so I was referred to a doctor who had then ordered a colonoscopy and endoscopy, and after that, I came out of the operating room, and so I went out of the hospital, went home, went to school, and a couple of days later, my parents had pulled me into their office and told me that I had severe Crohn's disease, and I was shocked. I didn't know what it was, what to do about it. I was very stressed, and I just didn't know what to do. And I was on herbal anti-inflammatories and such, and I was originally on just oral medications, and now I go in for an infusion around every 8 weeks, I think it is. And since then, I've shot up around 1 foot and 42 pounds. So that was just amazing. And ever since then, it's been a lot different. Just explaining how that happened is just amazing, because people like you do things like that for a living, and what you guys do has changed everyone like us, just our lives entirely. And so I want to thank you for that. Thank you.
Okay, and so we have Greg next.
Thank you. My name is Greg Garcia. I'm an attorney by day, and by about 15 years ago, I got interested in biotechnology and genetics and went back to school. So actually started taking some biology courses. A couple friends of mine were diagnosed with multiple sclerosis and muscular dystrophy. And so that was really the impetus for me to get interested. And then also, the state had just passed Prop 301. There was a bunch of funding flowing into Bio5, the Biodesign Institute. We were trying to bring a bunch of really smart people here to form TGen. And I thought this would be a great opportunity for me. And I even went back to law school and got a post-law school law degree in biotechnology and genomics. And that kind of took me off of a traditional legal path, and I got involved with the Arizona Bioindustry Association. And in fact, 3 years ago, while Cooper was probably going through this process, I was with his mother in Washington, D.C., Shannon, trying to advocate on behalf of folks like you and researchers and companies that need help at the legislative level, either for funding or from a regulatory standpoint. And it also led me to take a private equity stake in a little startup company here, and so I've had kind of a really diverse background. And this was all kind of going on until last year in January on President's Day. Or actually, I think it was Martin Luther King weekend. I was skiing with my wife and 2 daughters, and at the top of a mountain had sudden cardiac arrest. And it was about 11,000 feet, and there was no AED close, but they snowmobiled up one from another mountain. And after three shocks and about 10 to 15 minutes of CPR from a lot of angels, I survived. They flew me down to Scottsdale Osborne, and that's where I was for about a week. I owe my health to a lot of the folks in the back of the room here, from our friends at Medtronic here in Tempe. I am now wearing one of their Medtronic devices. And even before I had an implant, I had an external defibrillator that was assisting my heart during my recovery. And I remember specifically waking up one day or evening, I can't remember, it's all kind of hazy, and it's very quiet in my hospital room, and I could hear the sound. It kind of went like this, psh, boop, psh, boop, psh, boop. And I asked the nurse, I said, what is that thing? What is the sound? She just kind of nonchalantly looked up and she says, oh, that's just the thing that's keeping you alive. That's the external pacemaker. You know, I could see the little Medtronic name on there. And it was the external pacemaker. My heart was so weak that it really couldn't support itself. In fact, I crashed again in the hospital a couple days later, and they had to shock me to bring me back again. And that's when the decision was made to give me a permanent combination defibrillator pacemaker device. And it did its job. One of the mottos over at Medtronic is to restore health. And this device has restored my health. It retrained my heart. What I had was a virus. I had viral myocarditis, which is a subset of cardiomyopathy. And interestingly, there's a student next door with a poster on her research into cardiomyopathy and detecting biomarkers for it. So it's a very small world. And I'm very proud, as somebody who lives in Tempe, and I know our mayor, Mark Mitchell, is very proud to have a company like Medtronic here. And so it's interesting. I had this interest in biotechnology. I was involved and engaged. And next thing you know, I'm a patient of a medical device company here based right here in Tempe. So that's really kind of my basis and my story. Thank you.
So we've heard some very interesting stories, and I think in also different journeys, but there are also some similarities across the four different experiences that you heard. And one of the areas that I was thinking about, because a couple of you have mentioned this, who has touched you during your journey and so forth. So I wonder if you could expand a little bit around who worked with you or who stood out the most, maybe is a better question, in your mind during the journey, and how that changed you. Because each one of you had pretty good medical lingo capability, right? You didn't stutter over the words or anything. So who stood out in your mind during your journey and how that or how they may have changed you? And Greg, I'll start with you on the end, work the other way.
Well, you know, I was very fortunate to be honest with you, and the fact that I had a lot of contacts in this community, in the bio community here locally, and just reaching out to all those folks and sharing my story and getting some background help from them, and having a lot of, you know, heads nodding back and forth telling me they understood what I was going through, talking to my friends over at Medtronic. But I mean, I've got to tell you, I know I've mentioned their name a couple of times, but I literally woke up from a coma and they told me they were going to give me a pacemaker. And of course, being the lawyer I am, I argued with them a little bit until the doctor won that argument. And once I was resolved to get in the pacemaker, I said, okay, fine. And I turned to one of my best friends who was in my you know, hospital room, and I said, you got to call my friend over at Medtronic. And he did. He picked up my cell phone, found the name, called that person. That person happened to be in China, and said, Greg's getting a pacemaker. He wants to know what you got, what's the latest and greatest and best. And he gave recommendations. So, I mean, literally, it's that type of touch that I was lucky enough to get during my journey.
Okay. Cooper?
So, I'd have to say that the people that made the biggest impact on my journey with Crohn's disease would either be my parents, my family, and my doctor. My doctor has just been amazing, and as well as the doctor and my family, it's just the nurses, just everything that they do for me and for everyone else is just amazing to me, and just them taking their time and doing things like that for us is awesome. And once again, back to my doctor, he gave me the diagnosis, and As well as being very scared, I was also very thankful for it, so I knew what I was dealing with and I knew what I had to do. And so, yeah, that's pretty much it.
Okay, thanks. Sebastian.
So for me, I mean, first of all, it was family and friends, of course, but I wouldn't be here today if it hadn't been for my family's support. It is very humbling, but I'm very grateful for that, you know, to know that. And whenever I needed help, they were there all the way. And then actually, one of the biggest helps was actually the internet, because as dangerous as the internet is for a patient or anybody when you start looking stuff up, if you can exercise some, you know, kind of critical judgment, I mean, that's actually what led me to the proper diagnosis, which was later confirmed, you know, through the medical field and medical practitioners. And actually, once I've figured that out, I've connected with a lot of amazing just researchers and doctors online who work with these infections. And they are a lot of extraordinary people, because I think one of the hardest things for me was I did have quite a bit of bitterness not getting diagnosed for a long time and feeling, you know, all these kind of wasted years or whatever, but that's not really the right way to think about it, but you can kind of get looped into that thinking if... So, you know, there's... I found a lot of people in the medical field who are just really incredible, and that restored a lot of faith for me, which I'm happy, because there's a lot of people I have a high regard for the medical profession and research, but it's very difficult to practice, you know, and especially chronic cases and chronic diseases is you only have so much time with patients, so many resources. So, you know, I mean, I do understand why it's very difficult. So, but a lot of good people, I've gotten a lot of help and I really appreciate that. So,
great. Bonnie?
Dealing with any kind of illness, especially chronic illness, can definitely wear you down, and it can be a very lonely place to be, because we don't want to put a lot of burden on those that are our loved ones, because they become the caretakers and it's a lot of stress on them. So it's hard, like I said, when there's nowhere to turn. There are organizations for colon cancer and breast cancer and support groups, but there was no support group for me. And that's why the International Cancer Association Network, ICANN, really was there for me 24/7. I could call her on Saturday or Sunday anytime for any kind of questions or help. Email, text was always available to me. But one thing that's important to remember is our attitude. No matter what our disease is, it's our attitude. And trying to keep positive sometimes can be a challenge. And for me, the thing that has sustained me the very most out of everything has been my faith. And my faith, just even in the hardest days when I was down on my knees, all I had to do was look up. And that is really what has held me together and has brought me through the most difficult times.
Great. And thanks to each of you for sharing these types of insights and your stories. So one of the areas that AZBio and a lot of the other organizations, not only here in Arizona, but around the country, are interested in doing is the medical innovation, as well as the research, and trying to address unmet needs. So I think a logical question would be, what could the AZBio and broader community be doing, perhaps, to do a better job or to find a different solution or something else that would help you based on your own experience? And Cooper, I'll ask you to go first this time.
All right, so the one thing, just the one small thing that I would like you guys to do is a cure. That's just the one thing that has just been pushing me. And that's what I've been thinking about a lot. So that's really the only one thing.
Nice.
And Sebastian, I'll let you go next.
Sure. So I think one of the most important things for Lyme disease and the other tick-borne diseases is better diagnostics. I mean, it's easy to say, but very difficult to accomplish. I mean, people can come up with great proofs of concept for this, but it's really difficult to bring to the market at decent price points. And then the other issue, I think, because some people can manage these diseases pretty well and get better, and then for other people it's more difficult. And for that subset of patients, I think you know, we need to develop better more modalities and therapeutics that can be turned to, because it can be very difficult to treat these diseases. So those are really the two things I would say, and access to care. I think, unfortunately, as well, for these diseases, it's very difficult to get access to care, to therapeutics, and just seeing the doctors themselves. So, yeah.
Okay. Bonnie?
I just want to say, if there's anybody out there that's looking for somebody that you want to participate in your clinical trial, I'll be glad to donate my blood. I think that one thing that would help, and I know when there's such a variety as we have here, is how do you market all of this to get that information to the right people, which would be the healthcare providers? How do they find out about what it is that you have to offer? And is that through continuing education or in service, or how is that going to be? Because the important thing is to take all these wonderful things that you have and then to get them to market to places where they can benefit those of us that need it the most.
Great. Greg?
So, you know, the most important thing, I think, is we need more of a lot of the people in the audience here, the very smart and dedicated researchers and clinicians that are working on Cooper's Cure. But sometimes those folks need help from us, and they need it in ways that we don't always think about. So, for example, my daughter has a peanut allergy, and Joan and I helped out a couple years ago on getting some legislation in place that facilitated placement of EpiPens in schools, and same thing for AEDs. There was actually a legislative push throughout the country just in the last few years, maybe 10 years or so, to clear the way for more AEDs to be in public places such as these. And so we need help sometimes educating our legislators and policymakers on funding, on regulation, and removing some of these barriers. And it's also sometimes giving them some incentives as to why they, you know, the research that's, you know, sometimes seems like basic science actually has an impact on some of these folks up here on the panel. So that would be my ask, is that when the time comes and we reach out to you via email or Jones texts or blasts the bit.lys on your tables, that when we ask you to do these little things, you take a few minutes and just ping those policymakers and tell them you just want their support for biomedical research, medical research, or for some patient advocacy.
Okay, great. So you may notice we have a lot of lights on us up here. We are taping this, and there will be portions on YouTube as well. And so this is an opportunity for you in sharing your journey to reach out to those that could not be in the room with us today, and maybe comment or give one little quick closing soundbite that you'd like to communicate to those that couldn't be with us today, related to your patient journey and the issues that you've been dealing with. So I'll start with Bonnie.
I'm starting to sound like a commercial, but Marsha Horn couldn't be here today and was going to be here today. And I just want to give a shout out to Marsha for her dedication to the ICANN, the International Cancer Advocacy Network, and all they do to advocate for patients. And believe me, she's well aware of a lot of people that are in this room and a lot of the new technology that's going on, and has it at her fingertips at all times to talk to physicians. And if somebody like Sebastian or I called her and said, we're interested, and then we named a technology, she'd be able to help us find information about that technology and help us find a provider that would provide that technology for us. So I would just like to say thank you to her for everything that she does to help and advocate for patients.
Okay, I'm gonna go to the other end with Greg.
Sure, you know, the one thing I would urge on a broader messaging from this group is that, you know, a lot of times trade associations like ours are misinterpreted in terms of their mission. Our mission isn't about jobs. And it's not about taking government money. It's about the folks that are up here on this panel, because the work that you all do in the audience and our members do in our companies and the drug providers and medical device providers, they have impacts on these folks and these real lives. And that's what our focus is, and that's what I would hope to spread through YouTube.
Okay, Cooper?
So, to the people who couldn't be here, I just want to say that you have done miracles for everybody who has been standing up here, everyone who hasn't been, and to the patients and people that are just out there who haven't found a cure. If you guys can find an amazing doctor like some of these people that are standing in front of me right now, you will be extremely lucky just to have one of these people in your lives. It's amazing. Just thank you.
Sebastian.
Well, I would just have to thank everyone and all those who support patients or people going through difficult things that maybe we don't always quite understand what their condition is, what their suffering might be, but they extend compassion and kindness. And that is one of the amazing silver linings when you go through something, is the kindness that is extended to you. Even if someone doesn't understand something you're going through, it's very powerful. And, you know, I'm very grateful to, you know, and so many patients, you know, they struggle. And so to have that is one of the most amazing gifts. And we're just very grateful for that. So thank you.
Great. Well, I appreciate our great panel. The time flew, and I think we got some great insights. So thanks, Greg, Cooper, Sebastian, and Bonnie. And they'll be around, I believe, for the rest of the afternoon, and we have a closing reception. And I'll turn it back to Joan.